So welcome back. So in this third lecture, we'll be talking about probabilistic models for doing classification. I'll also spend some time talking about a class of models known as latent variable models that are again very powerful way, which again provide us a very powerful way for doing probabilistic modeling of data. And towards the end, I'll spend some time talking about some of the other topics that I feel are basically quite exciting and upcoming areas in probabilistic machine learning. That you should probably explore after these lectures. So let me get started with probabilistic classification. So what are so again in the previous class we looked at probabilistic models for doing solving regression problems. In this lecture I'll start off by talking about probabilistic models for solving classification problems. Now, if I understand correctly, there was a previous lecture on logistic regression-based classification that is essentially a probabilistic model for doing classification. So knowing that, I would not talk much about logistic regression, but I will still talk about some other ways of doing probabilistic classification. So if we think of classification problems and try to solve them using probabilistic models, then there are basically two type of broad, methods that can be used to solve these problems using probabilistic models. The first approach is known popularly as discriminative classification, and some of the examples of these models include logistic or softmax regression. So the reason these models are called discriminative classification is because they formulate the classification problem directly in terms of trying to classify, an example into, one or two or more classes. Using a directly defined function. The other class of problems that are used, the other class of models that are used for classification are known as generative classification. There again, the goal is to do classification, but sort of in an indirect way by coming up with a generative model for the data that you're trying to classify and using that generative model to then define a probability of a class given the input. We will look at these in more detail. So some of the examples of generative classification include methods like naive Bayes classification. Some of you might have heard about naive Bayes or Gaussian classifiers, where you basically you assume that each class that you have is modeled by a Gaussian distribution, right? So and then based on that, you for every class you learn a Gaussian distribution, and given a test point, you decide the label based on under which class it has the largest probability. Okay, so that's the basic idea in Gaussian classifiers, and also in generative classification in general. So as I was saying earlier, if we think of discriminative classification like logistic regression or softmax, these models directly define the probability of y given x. So note that here y is a discrete label. So if we are solving a binary classification problem, then y can take one of the two values, 0, 1, or minus 1, or plus 1. Or if we have a multi-class problem, there we can have more than two classes. Okay. So and then one of the k-many classes would be the true label. And so these discriminative models directly define the probability that for any given input x, the true label is equal to k. This probability is defined as this so-called softmax function. So it simply says that this probability is defined as a ratio of exp of wk transpose x divided by the summation of these exp wl transpose x. Okay. So here, with every class, let's say small k, you have a weight vector wk. Okay, so essentially what this definition is telling us is that we define the probability that the label is small k, and this probability is proportional to the score that that this data point x gets under the kth class. So for with every class k, you have a weight vector wk. So in some sense, you score this example using this weight vector wk, right? And you exponentiate and you normalize. So you can see that this is a probability, right? If you sum this score over all possibilities of k, it will sum to 1. Okay, so if I sum this thing over small k equal to 1 to capital K, this will sum to 1. Okay, so this is a valid probability estimate. So note that in this definition of a probability of this input being the label being k given x is directly defined using this function. We are saying that, well, here is a function. It's clearly a probability. Let's use this function. Let's try to infer the unknown. So what are the unknowns here? The unknowns are the weights, right? With every class, you have a weight vector, W1, W2, up to W capital K. Okay, so we can define this model and we can try to learn the weight vectors. Okay, using our favorite, optimizer, we can also use MLE or MAP or Bayesian inference to learn these weight vectors. I'm not going to talk about the estimation in general, but you can define this. So this defines your likelihood model, right? So this is the likelihood model. These are the parameters. You can define a prior over every parameter and then do MLE, MAP, or Bayesian inference. So that is what logistic regression or softmax regression, you know, is about. The other type of classification models that I'm going to focus on are generative classification. So what are generative classification models? Well, again, the idea is to compute this probability that what is the probability that for this input X, the true label, the predicted label is like, the label is K. So generative classification defines P of Y given X, which is the probability of the label given input, in terms of what is known as the marginal probability, which is denoted as P of Y, and the class conditional probability X given Y. Okay, so you can think of X given Y as the probability distribution of the inputs given that you know the class. Okay, so for every class, you can assume that there is a probability distribution over the inputs belonging to that class. Okay, so that is what P of X given Y. So note that this is the conditional probability of X given that you know the label. Okay, so if we have access to P of Y and P of XY, we can use the Bayes rule to compute P of Y given X, okay, which is nothing but P of Y times P of X given Y divided by P of X. Okay, so this is a two-step procedure to compute P of Y given X. Okay, we are first estimating P of X given Y and P of Y, and then combining these two using the Bayes rule to compute this probability. In contrast, the discriminative classification approach directly defines P of Y equal to K given X using this softmax function or a sigmoid function. Okay, so that is the key difference between discriminative classification and generative classification. Yeah, so you estimate these from data. I'll talk about how we estimate that, right? So the thing, yeah, so in order to, so, yeah. Well, it's just one way of defining the probabilities, because you, first of all, P of Y, so this is a probability, right? So it has to be positive, right? So if you just use W transpose X divided by sum of W transpose X, you will not be guaranteed to get a positive number, right? So you just, it's just a way of defining a probability, okay? Yeah. Multi-class, yeah. Softmax is basically a multi-class generalization of logistic, yeah. Right. So as we have seen in the discriminative classification approach, the parameters that we are trying to learn are these weight vectors. Whereas in the generative classification, what are we trying to learn? Well, we would actually be learning these distributions, P of Y and P of X given Y. So once we can learn these distributions, then we can plug those in this equation, and then we can compute the probability of the label being K given the input. How do we learn P of Y and P of X given Y is the question, right? So how do we do that? So first of all, this, if you can also express this denominator as a sum of this the same quantity in the numerator, but summed over all possibilities of the classes. Okay, so this is the expanded version. So if you look at this equation, you are basically, you, what do you want in order to apply the generative classification rule? Well, you need an estimate of what is P of Y equal to K. Okay, and you also need an estimate of what is P of X given Y, taking a specific value K. So if we can somehow estimate these distributions, then we have solved the generative classification problem. Okay. So how do we estimate these distributions? First of all, let's establish some nomenclature. So P of Y is called the class marginal distribution, which basically means that a priori, like, or what fraction of, you know, examples are, you know, present from each class. Okay. So P of Y, so you can compute P, so Y can take one of K possible values if there are K classes in the data, right? So I can compute P of Y equal to 1, P of Y equal to 2, up to P of Y equal to K, right? By looking at the training data and simply seeing what fraction of examples are coming from each of the classes, right? So if I have, let's say, 30% examples from the positive class, 70% examples from the negative class, then P of Y equal to 0 is like, if positive class is like 1, then it's 30%. So it's like, you can just empirical, fraction will be these probabilities. So these can be estimated by just looking at the training data. You ignore the features, you just look at what fraction of labels are there from each class. That will give you this distribution. This is just a discrete distribution, right? P of Y, right? So you can compute P of Y equal to 1. P of Y equal to 1 is basically the fraction of labels with label 1. P of Y equal to 2 is the fraction of examples with label 2, and so on. Okay. Now, the thing is, you can also be a bit more rigorous in computing P of Y. So when I say that, you can simply compute the fraction that's basically doing MLE estimation. But you can also incorporate some prior knowledge about what fraction of examples are there from each class. So there are many ways of estimating P of Y. You can do MLE, you can do MAP, and so on. So likewise, so let me just show you the basic. So what I'm talking about here is that you can have P of Y, right? So in order to compute this, you basically have to compute P of Y equal to 1, P of Y equal to 2, and so on. P of Y equal to capital K. And as I said, a very naive way would be to simply count the fraction of examples that are belonging to each of the classes, and that defines this probability distribution. But you can be slightly more rigorous about it, and you can say that, well, rather than using these empirical frequencies, I can say that P of Y is basically defined by a categorical or multinally distribution with a parameter vector pi. So you can say that this is basically pi 1 up to pi capital K. Okay. So multinally distribution or multinomial distribution is a distribution that will produce one of k possible values if you draw from it. Okay. So pi 1 up to pi k are not known, right? So these are the parameters of this distribution. You can now, if you can do MLE on these parameters, which will give you precisely these estimates. Or you can put priors on these parameters and infer the posterior distribution on, right? So if you do just pi MLE, then that will basically give you this thing, right? On the other hand, if you, let's say, impose a prior distribution on pi, okay, so then you can do a map or Bayesian inference about this probability distribution. So that becomes a bit tricky. I mean, we have not talked about such estimation problems, but the basic idea is that essentially when we are learning P of Y, we are learning this probability vector, okay? We can estimate that probability vector using MLE, which will give us just these estimates. Intuitively, this is what the solution will be. But we can also say that, well, let's assume a prior over pi, this pi vector. So pi is a k-dimensional vector, okay? This vector also sums to 1, right? Because these are the class probability. What is the probability that a label is from class 1 to up to capital K? So if we think of this probability vector pi equal to pi 1 through pi capital K, this vector must sum to 1, okay? So if we are going to do a map estimation or Bayesian inference for pi, then we must start with some prior distribution over pi. Now, what is a good prior for a parameter that is a probability vector, which sums to 1? So there is something called, which is, again, not the scope of this lecture, but I'll anyway mention. So you can use something called a Dirichlet prior, which is a prior distribution over vectors that sum to 1. So with the Dirichlet prior and your training data, you can actually get a map estimate or a Bayesian estimate of P of Y. Okay, so the bottom line is that once you have your training data, then you can learn P of Y using either MLE or MAP or Bayesian inference. Okay, so that will basically solve one part of the problem where we have to estimate P of Y. The other part is to estimate P of X given Y. Okay, so how do we estimate that? Well, in fact, we have already looked at such a problem in lecture one itself, that if I am given some data, and if I assume that the data is coming from a Gaussian, I can estimate the mean and variance of the Gaussian. Okay, so estimating P of X given Y is basically taking the data from every class, right? And then assuming that the data is, let's say, Gaussian distributed, just estimating the mean and covariance matrix of the Gaussian. Okay, so this is just because we already know the label, so we know which data, which example comes from which class. Okay, so we can, using that, we can just do density estimation for these examples. So again, let me just show it using a picture. So the basic idea is that suppose we want to estimate P of X. Not P of X, but yeah. So suppose I want to estimate this, right? So in order to estimate this, I have to basically estimate the following. So P of X given Y equal to 1 through P of X given Y equal to capital K, assuming we have capital K classes. Now we have to make some assumption. We have to assume that each of these distributions is basically some probability distribution. Okay, let's say a Gaussian distribution. So if we assume that each of these distributions is a Gaussian distribution, then each of these distributions will have some parameter, right? And the parameters can be, like, for the first one, we can have a Gaussian with parameters mu 1, sigma 1. And likewise, for this one, we can have a Gaussian with parameter mu capital K and sigma capital K. Okay, now, given data from every class, we can estimate the parameters, right? We can do, again, MLE or MAP or Bayesian inference to estimate the parameters. Okay. Is it clear? The other thing is that if your data is not real-valued vector, so Gaussian will be a good assumption if the data is real-valued vector. So if your X's are, let's say, d-dimensional inputs, then Gaussian is appropriate. However, if your x's are, let's say, binary vectors or count vectors, then you may have to use other distributions like a Bernoulli distribution or a Poisson distribution. But depending on the data, you can choose an appropriate distribution, and then you can estimate the parameters of that distribution. Okay, and you have to do it for every class, and that will give you p of x given y, because once you have estimated this distribution for every class, so that's basically a density estimation task. Okay, for you take the data from every class, you estimate the probability distribution of the data from that class, and you learn the parameters, okay? And that all these basically will together will constitute this distribution P of X given Y. Okay, is this part clear? Any questions on this? Okay, so we have seen both things, like we can estimate P of Y as well as P of X given Y, yeah, using our like MLE estimate or map estimate or Bayesian inference, okay? So this is the point I was making, that once we are given the label data from every class, we can estimate P of Y equal to K and P of X given Y equal to K. Once we have estimates of these, given any test input, all we have to do is plug in these. So we can evaluate P of Y equal to K for every value of K, and then whichever K gives the largest value, that will be the class of that input. Okay, clear? Note that we can also think of a simpler version of this problem, where if P of Y equal to K is the same for every class, suppose, you know, there are K classes and P of and every class is, we expect that every class is equally represented, right? In that case, we can just ignore this part, right? We can simply like look at P of X given Y equal to K, which is the simple approach. So suppose I have data from K classes, I simply estimate the distribution of each of the K classes and simply look at the probability of the data under each class, right? And that the class having the largest probability will be the predicted class. However, incorporating this kind of, you know, also helps you influence the class sizes, because some classes may be minority, some may be like, some may have lots of examples. So having this helps you, you know, take that into account. So that's how you solve generative classification. Okay. So again, I'm not getting into the technical details of it. I'm just trying to provide a high-level idea as to what is generative classification and how it is different from discriminative classification. Again, generative classification uses this simple two-step procedure rule, where in the first step, you estimate the probability of Y equal to K and the class, basically the class marginal and the class conditional distribution. Once you have learned these distributions, how you learn these distributions is up to you. If you want to do MLE or MAP, and using point estimate, you know, you can do that. If you want to do a lot more computation, and you can do the Bayesian approach, where you can actually average over the posterior and do all sorts of things that we did in the previous two lectures. All right? Yeah. Well, so it depends. So, I mean, it's the model is taking into account both. It's not necessarily biased towards that, because you would also have the probability of the input given the class, right? So it's just that you are looking at the classes that have, yeah, so in some sense, yeah, so it's kind of a prior information, right? That, yeah, there is maybe one class that is majority, right? So maybe it's more likely that the test example will be from that class. But you're not entirely going by that information. You do have the other piece, right? X given Y equal to K. So if you're basically taking into account both, like the a priori information about the class, you know, biases, and then the probability, like, and also the fact that what the input looks like under each of the classes. If both are high, then the product will be high, and then, yeah.
And sir, what if I was having no many examples of some other class which I want to learn?
Yes.
But it's occurring in test data.
Yeah, yeah.
In that case, it's going to be zero.
Zero, yes. Yeah, yeah. So typically, we expect that all the classes are represented in the training data. Okay. However, there is one more caveat, that it might happen that in the training data, some classes are very, like, some have very few examples. Right. For those classes, these distributions cannot be estimated very reliably, because if you want to estimate the distribution of a class, you need sufficient training data. Right. And that is when the Bayesian approach will be useful, because the Bayesian approach can learn parameters even if we have very little amount of data, because it will use a prior distribution over the parameters of the classes, right? Right?
Is there a way where we sometimes incorporate like Bayesian correction?
Yeah, yeah. So that's basically, so the using the prior is basically the this like Laplace smoothing, actually. Yeah. So if you just use MLE, then of course the classes that are like very scarce or like they have no examples, they will just not be like predicted, right? So Laplacian smoothing, or it's basically like a simple way of saying that we are using a prior distribution. So using prior is basically what you're talking about. Okay, but as I said, yeah, if you have some classes that are kind of underrepresented, you know, and you may not, and for those classes, you can't really get a good estimate of these class conditional distribution, right? So you better use a Bayesian approach where you properly incorporate a prior distribution and regularize the parameters so that you don't overfit, right? Because essentially for the classes for which you have don't have enough data, you will overfit very easily, right? And using a Bayesian approach, you can avoid overfitting. Yeah. So hopefully the difference between discriminative classification and generative classification is clear. Yeah.
Can you explain how the Bayesian approach
helps in
cases
where we have very less representative classes? Yeah. So let's look at this. So suppose, you know, we have some class for which we have, let's say, just two or three examples, right? And if we try to fit a Gaussian distribution to that class, it will probably not have a good estimate of the mean. However, if we also incorporate a prior distribution over the mean of that class, as we did in lecture one, right? So what we talked about in lecture one was we were trying to estimate the mean of a Gaussian distribution, right? So suppose we just keep our estimation simple. We say that covariance matrix, we don't want to, we know what covariance matrix is, but we just want to estimate the mean. If we have very few examples, then it makes more sense to incorporate a prior distribution over, then let's not do MLE, right? Let's actually use Bayesian approach or map approach. So what we will do in that case, we will put a prior distribution over the mean and covariance matrix of, let's look at this, right? So mu and sigma, we are trying to learn mu and sigma for every class, okay? Now, if there is some class for which we have very few examples, right? Then it may make sense to put a prior distribution over mu and sigma so that, you know, we can do a Bayesian. So otherwise, we will just be computing the empirical, you know, mean empirical covariance, right? But having a prior distribution on these mu and sigma will help us get their posterior distribution, and then we can use their posterior distribution to do averaging. So we can do a lot more. We can basically do a lot of all the Bayesian basically averaging that we have seen in the previous lecture. Just to like avoid notational clutter, I did not have any of those things, but you can do Bayesian inference in this setting. Okay, the point behind, you know, this discussion is to just show you the basic difference between discriminative classification and generative classification, and to show you how generative classification can be learned using the training data they have, and what sort of quantities we have to estimate. And the only two we only have to estimate these two quantities, P of y equal to k and P of x given y equal to k. Both of these can be estimated using training data, using any appropriate estimation methods, MLE, MAP, or Bayesian inference. Okay. Yeah, the other thing to remember is that in discriminative classification, we are not modeling x, right? Again, recall the discussion of linear regression. There also, we were just modeling y. We were not modeling x, right? See, there is no model for x. There is no distribution for x that we are assuming here. Whereas in the generative classification, yes, we are assuming that there is a distribution over x conditioned on y, right? So generative classification models x. Discriminative classification does not model x. And it has certain benefits, and it has both disadvantages and advantages that I'll talk about later. Okay, so let's like discuss some of the aspects about generative classification. First of all, it's very simple, right? All you have to do is basically estimate these distributions and then plug in these distributions in this expression to get the probabilities. Okay, so it's very, very simple. Especially simple if the class conditional distributions, P of x given y, are simple distributions like a Gaussian. Gaussians, we know how to estimate the mean and covariance matrix. It's fairly easy, right? Even for something like Bernoulli. So in fact, most of the distributions you can estimate very easily if you have plenty of data. If you don't have plenty of data, then you have to do, let's say, you have to incorporate prior information, and you know, but you can still do that, right? Moreover, you know, even if you're assuming that every class is a Gaussian, it will have a mean and covariance matrix, but the covariance matrix has d by d parameters, right? Covariance matrix, if you have d-dimensional data. So one simplification that people often make when learning generative classification models is that they assume that the Gaussian has a diagonal covariance. So this covariance matrix, we assume that all the off-diagonal entries are zero, so we don't have to estimate those, we only have to estimate the diagonal entries. Okay, and this simplification leads to a model called Gaussian naive Bayes, where the each class conditional distribution P of x given y is a Gaussian whose covariance matrix is diagonal. So this is called naive Bayes. It's called naive because you assume, if you assume a diagonal covariance matrix, it assumes that the features are independent given the class label. Okay, so again, I think it might be clear if I just write it. So the idea is that I might have it on the one of the later slides, but the idea is as follows. So suppose I have this P of, suppose I want to estimate this, and let's say this is a normal distribution with some mean and some diagonal covariance, let's say lambda 1 up to lambda d. So this is my covariance matrix. Okay, I can show, so you can easily show that this is equal to product of, so this is the d-dimensional normal distribution, right? I can write it up as a product of d many one-dimensional Gaussian distributions, right? So it's basically by the way, this is x given, you know, mu and sigma. So this would be xd, again, xd given, so this is x. Yeah, let me just, yeah, so this is xd given mu. So mu d is the dth component of the mean vector, and the precision or variance can be like just lambda d. So this is the naive Bayes assumption, which says that given the class label, the feature, so here this is a product over the d features, right? So given the class label, the features are class conditionally, you know, independent. Okay, so this is the, and this simplifies the estimation, because now, you know, how many parameters you have to estimate if you are estimating this class? D parameters for mu and D parameters for the covariance matrix. In contrast, if you have a full covariance matrix, then you have order of D squared parameters for every entry in the diagonal in this covariance matrix. Okay, so another popular example is the so-called multinomial naive Bayes. So again, this naive Bayes assumption basically says that if you know the class label, then if you assume that the features are independent, then it leads to a naive Bayes assumption. And depending on the class type of class conditional distribution, you can have Gaussian naive Bayes or multinomial naive Bayes and other types of naive Bayes model. And that's basically what I was talking about. So naive Bayes models simply assume, say that probability distribution of the feature vector x given the class y, which is for which the parameters are, let's say, theta y, all the parameters are collectively denoted by theta y in this notation. It's basically a product over all the features given theta y. In fact, it should be theta y d here. And it reduces the number of parameters to be estimated. Okay. Another nice thing about generative classification is that, you know, it seamlessly works for any number of classes. So if you have more classes, you just have to estimate more class conditional distributions, right? So 10 classes, you know, 20 classes, you just have to estimate more distributions, right? So there's no extra work you have to do. And besides, you have a lot of freedom in terms of, you know, what type of class conditional distribution you can choose, right? So depending on the type of feature vector, right? So if you have text data, then some other, you know, Gaussian may not be the right probability class conditional distribution to choose. So in that case, you may have to choose a multinomial or Bernoulli, multivariate Bernoulli distribution. So just depending on depending on the type of data that you are dealing with, you can choose the appropriate class conditional distribution. You can also handle missing data. So if some of the components of your feature vector are missing, you can actually estimate those because you have a probabilistic models. I'm not going to deal with those details right now. One very nice aspect about this is that these models, the generative classification models, also work with semi-supervised learning setting. So semi-supervised learning setting is basically the problem setting where you are learning with both labeled data and unlabeled data. Because typically when we learn a classifier, we expect that we are learning from some labeled data. We have all the examples as labeled. But oftentimes, even unlabeled data can tell us about where the decision boundaries might lie. Okay. And just to give you an intuition as to why that is the case. So suppose I have, maybe these examples, okay? So where do you think the decision boundary lies? Well, maybe somewhere here, right? Three positive, one negative. However, suppose I give you lots of unlabeled examples, I don't tell you whether they're positive or negative, right? And suppose my examples are like, all the unlabeled examples are like, so these are unlabeled examples, and I have like some more unlabeled examples. Let's say, right? Right. So suppose I have like the unlabeled examples, they appear in two clumps basically, like so one and the other, right? As you can see, like it seems like the decision boundary is not exactly here, you know, the decision boundary is kind of here, even though, you know, this part is not labeled, it kind of says that this part is also just the negative class example, right? So the unlabeled data can often tell us about the structure of the data or kind of the clusters that are present in the data, and that can be leveraged to improve our estimation of the decision boundary that we are learning. Okay, so unlabeled data in general helps. It's an area called semi-supervised learning. Semi-supervised means it's partly supervised and partly unsupervised. Okay, so generative models are useful because they can be used in semi-supervised learning because they do model the distribution of the inputs given the class labels. Okay, so they are useful for semi-supervised learning as well. Generative models. Yes. However, we are computing P of X However, there exists generative model that work purely in the unsupervised setting. We will very briefly. So even a clustering model is like that, right? In clustering, there's no Y, right? You only have some cluster ID of every data point, but the cluster ID is not observed. Okay. But you can learn that cluster ID, right? So that makes it an unsupervised problem. We'll very briefly talk about a mixture model. Which is kind of a generative classification, but with the labels hidden. Okay.